the walls, when you finish some project, when you're, you know, it all started when you were in LKG or UKG or first standard, second standard. You started doing cursive handwriting, and when you did cursive handwriting, your teacher said, wow, Adishaka. You know, you did many things, you achieved many things in life, and people said, wow, those wows will not ultimately satisfy you. There's still an emptiness. There's still something missing. Still you are thirsty. Ecclesiastes chapter 2 verse 25, the Bible says, only God, without God, we can't eat or find enjoyment. And if you read Ecclesiastes, life under the sun, whatever you do under the sun, you're a student, you're, you know, whatever you do, sinful things, non-sinful things, whatever you do under the sun will not satisfy you, will not quench your thirst unless you have a relationship with the one above the sun. Who's above the sun? God, your creator. That's why the book of Ecclesiastes says, remember your creator in the days of your youth. One valiba kalathil, one srishtikarai, ninai. Because when you are young, you know, you want to do 100 things. No, older people will think and do things, but young people do things and then think. But in this period, you know, God is telling you, the only thing that can quench your thirst, don't miss it. So he repeats himself, is me, a relationship that you have with me, a relationship that you have with me. When she was still a college student, I may be wrong here, but when she was still in college, a girl called Monica got a job to work in the president's office. Bill Clinton, the US president then, would see Monica. She was a little chubby girl, a little overweight. And then Bill Clinton, a man with the gift of the gab, a man who perhaps has earned more through speaking than anybody else in the world, just through for speaking fees. Great oratory when he talks to millions of people, also great in oratory when he talks to a girl. You know what he said to Monica Lewinsky? You walk around, you are always smiling and so bubbly, but there's so much sadness behind those eyes. This is what Bill Clinton told Monica Lewinsky, just a college girl who came to work in his office. You walk around, you're always smiling and so bubbly, but there's so much sadness behind those eyes. Now he was talking to her like this with the evil intention of starting a sexual relationship with her, which he started. We know the story. But you know what? That's the truth. So many of us walk around, we are so bubbly on the outside, but inside we are bleeding. But inside we are broken. Inside there's something missing. We are loud on the outside, but lonely on the inside. We are jolly on the outside. Inside we are jaded. We are thirsty. And only one person can quench that thirst, and that's Jesus. And that's Jesus. That's Jesus. The next word, the humility, verse 15. The humility. I want you to read, one of you, in Tamil, verse 15. John chapter 4, verse 15, the humility. Sir, the woman said to him, give me this water, so I will not get thirsty and come here to draw water. This woman could have told Jesus, what rubbish are you talking? She could have said, what rubbish are you talking? What tall claims are you making? No, Jesus did not do any miracle before her. Jesus did not heal the sick before her. Jesus did not raise the dead before her. Jesus was making a claim before her that, you know, that he would be the one who can quench her thirst. You know, but you know what? This woman took Jesus at his word. Maybe she misunderstood Jesus. She was looking for a literal water. a literal water. But she took Jesus' word. She kept telling Jesus, you don't know, do you know what you're talking? What rubbish are you talking? She said, I want that water. That speaks of our humility. That speaks of our humility. Now when God's word comes to you this morning, I want you to receive it with humility. It's when Jesus encounters you today, His word encounters you today. Don't for a moment think, oh, this word which Anand said exactly is for my friend who lives in that particular room in the hostel. No, it's for you. If you're humble, you'll say it's for me. If you're arrogant, you'll say, oh, this will fit my younger sister who is studying in Chennai. It's for you. She said, I want it. I want that water. I want that water. The humility. You know, the world, people who don't know Jesus Christ, they have a lot of humility. But we who know Jesus Christ don't have that humility. You know, I read, when after Deepika Padukone worked with Rajinikanth for the movie Kochadai, and she said, I have never seen a more humble man and more passionate man than Rajinikanth. People who don't know Jesus Christ are humble. But you, what about you? Are you humble? Are you humble? The sixth thing I learned, and I want to go quickly now. The dirty, verse 16 to 19. I want you to read 16, 17, 18 and 19. Jesus is talking about the dirt in her life because the Holy Spirit revealed to him the dirt in her life, the dirty. Okay, 16, 17, 18 and 19 of John chapter 4. Yes. Yes. Madam, go call your husband. I don't have a husband. You know, we are like that. You know, when God starts talking things that are personal in our life, when you know, we try to pretend before God. I don't have a husband. Maybe she thought Jesus will shut his mouth then and there. She thought maybe Jesus will shut his mouth then and there when she said, I don't have any husband. You know, we put our defenses when God's word comes to you. It's maybe coming to you this morning, young lady. Maybe it came to you when you read the Bible. Maybe when your friend who knows Jesus Christ talked with you, when you took a long walk, when you walked through these trees, when this friend talked about your personal life, you raised your defenses and you said, shut up. That's far you can come, and you can't come close to me and ask me these personal questions. Now Jesus is getting personal. He's unveiling her dirty life. Go ahead. Yes. You're right when you said, I don't have a husband. Because you had five husbands. And presently, you know, I may be wrong, but she was living in with a man who's not married. They're living in together. Yes. And what did she say? What did she say? Verse 19. Yes. I see that you're a prophet. You know what? Even at that point, she could have tried to hide or she could have just ran away. But she still continues to talk with Jesus. Jesus reveals that he is dirty. She's dirty. Which means she has lived with five men. She has broken God's laws. Maybe she married husband number one, not satisfied, divorced him or ran away from him and married second one, the third one, the fourth one, the fifth one. Maybe she was not satisfied with relationship number one and then she went to relationship number two, not satisfied, relationship number three, relationship number four. You know, instead of, you know, when it comes to relationship, I'm not preaching about relationship. You know, every relationship will work when there is give and take. But when you want to only take from another person, chances are the relationship will break. And when it comes to marriage, I will talk about marriage in my talk tomorrow with someone tomorrow. You know, but when it comes to marriage is all about giving. If you're not able to give in a marriage, don't get married. That's the message of John, Genesis 24. Genesis 24. What do we read? What was the acid test to find a life partner for Isaac? Can the woman give water for me? And not only nothing for me but the camels. Why? What is that connection to do with marriage? What is the connection? Because marriage is about giving. Maybe, I don't know, the Bible doesn't give the details. This lady was a selfish lady, or maybe this lady, went into a marriage with a set view. The husband did not fulfill it, throw him out. And then second man, throw him out. Third man, throw him out. She had a very bad relationship. She was not willing to give and take. I don't know. I may be wrong here. I'm just speculating. But Jesus, reveals her life to him. Reveals her life to him. And then, right now, she lost belief in the institution of marriage. And she was living in with a man. She could have told Jesus, what are? But she said, prophet. She could have told Jesus, what are? But Jesus, she called him prophet. Which means, what you say about me, Jesus, is true. I'm a dirty person. I'm a sinner. I'm bad. Like Michael Jackson sang, I'm bad. I'm a sinner. Bible says in Proverbs 23:28-13, if whoever conceals their sins will not prosper. How many of you want to prosper? You want to prosper? Don't conceal your sin. That's what the Bible says. Don't conceal your sin. You want to prosper? Don't conceal your sin. Whoever conceals a sin does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. That's what the Bible says in Proverbs 28:13. But whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. Seventhly, we are coming to the last few minutes of this message. It's a little long line, the seventh point. Not the worship itinerary. Itinerary means you go from one place to another place. Not the worship itinerary, but unity with the deity. Not the worship itinerary, but unity with the deity. Now, the passage is between 20 to 26. We won't read it. Now, Jesus is talking to this woman. They talk about places of worship. The woman says, our fathers worshipped on this mountain. Yet you Jews say that this the place to worship is Jerusalem. Samaritans worship somewhere else on the mountain. But the Jewish people worship in Jerusalem. But Jesus says it's not about worshiping in Jerusalem or in that mountain. It's not about the itinerary where you worship. It's not whether you worship here or there. It's not about the worship itinerary. But what counts is what? Unity with the deity. God is looking for people who will worship him in spirit and in truth. It's not where you worship, but what matters is the person you worship, who is the living God, and how you worship, in spirit and in truth. How you worship in truth? You worship the only true God, who is Jesus. Not anything that you see. That is worshiping in truth. If Jesus is the only God, and he is the only God in flesh, you must worship him only. You say, well, I only worship Jesus. Really? But by the time you spend on your phone and the time you spend on Jesus, I thought you and I are worshiping the phone. We might say, I worship Jesus only, but that our worship should be sincere and it should be real. Not token worship. Parent worship under. Ullathilirundhu unmaya. Now, how do you know that? What is worship? When you get married, in the CSI Anglican tradition, they'll say, with my body I worship thee. That's one of the statements when the husband says to the wife, with my body I worship thee. Which means their union is going to be like he's going to be everything for her. So that is worship. Now that's uses an analogy here, which means your dreams, your ambitions, your life, your words, your vocabulary, your talents, your everything, when you give to Jesus, when you give to God the Father through the power of the Holy Spirit, that is true worship. something. God is calling you for that kind of worship. And if you don't know Jesus and you're living far away from Him, the first act of worship that you can do to Jesus today is to repent from sin and give your life to Jesus, surrender your life to Jesus, and that will be your first act of worship. Not just lifting your hand and saying, praise the Lord. That's not worship. That's just a small part of worship. Worship is to give your life to Jesus. Worship is not to go from one place to another place. Okay, I go here. It's not about an itinerary. It's about a person. And it's not only about that person. How? Some of us worship the right God, that is Jesus. But how do we worship Him? Token worship. We are namesake Christians. No, that's not going to be good enough. Worship the right person. Worship Him in spirit and in truth. He said, in this passage, He says, I am He, which means I am the true God that you should worship. It's not about worshiping in Jerusalem or in that mountain, but about, you know, this passage doesn't say it. You know what? It's about kneeling down before Jesus, who went and died for you on that mountain called Calvary, where He gave His everything. Where He gave His everything. 2004, when I preached in this place, I remember. You were not there, maybe some of your faculty members were there. I brought with me a picture book, because in 2004 was the movie Passion released. How many of you have seen the movie Passion? The last 12 hours of Jesus' life. My entire message was speaking about that, how Jesus climbed that mountain. Now before He climbed that mountain, He went to the garden. His sweat became like great drops of blood. Why? He was trying, you know, if I can use that phrase, He was trying to worship, I'm using it as an analogy, Jesus was trying to show how much He loved you. He shed His blood for you. And then He picked up and then they whipped Him on the back. His back became like a plowed field. Your body sinned, it should be punished. My body sinned, it should be punished. But Jesus climbed up that mountain. And now before that, His body was punished 39 times. Like those strong Roman soldiers, as strong as Salman Khan, when they beat Him up with these leather whips, with broken bone pieces, broken metal pieces, broken nails stuck onto its ends. When they beat Jesus on the back, you know, blood came out, strips of flesh came out. You know, He was dying for you. He was dying for me. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him. Where is peace? Not in that relationship you have with that boy. Where is peace? You know, not because you will end up going to the United States. Where is peace? Not because you will go to the top corporate company and get a job there. There is only one place where you will find peace. It is in the cross of Jesus. It is in the mountain called Golgotha. You know, where Jesus, you know, climbed up that mountain on Calvary's cross. He died in that place you find peace. And what is Jesus saying? This is the message of the Bible. You need to climb up that mountain, not this mountain, not the mountain this woman talked about in John chapter 4. Not climbing that mountain to worship in the temple there, but climb Calvary's mountain and kneel down. Ange ulangal panitte andavare inga vaake ungalku arpanikiren enakkaga siluvai marathile marithire ennudaiya ore vaake ungalku muluvadumai oppu kodukiren andavare endru solradhu. That is worship. That's the worship He wants. Not to go to this mountain which this woman was going, or not even go to Jerusalem where all the Jews were worshipping, but climb that mountain where Jesus died, shed His blood, and say, my life, you did this for me, I should be punished, I'm giving my life to you. Then these disciples come, verse 8, the next one, the jittery, G-I-T-T-E-R-Y, the jittery, verse 27. The disciples came and they said, they were amazed to see Him talk with a woman. And no one said, what do you want? Why are you talking to her? The disciples, they want to get something. They come back and they see Jesus talking with this woman. They are jittery. You Now, when you come to Jesus, when you start living for Jesus, when you take a U-turn and start living for Jesus, there will be people who get jittery around you, people who get uncomfortable. They'll call you some names. They'll call you Mother Teresa. They will call you by not so complimentary names. They will be uncomfortable. When they see you talk with Jesus, when they see you with Jesus, people around you will get uncomfortable. I can tell you, it will happen in our college because you will be a minority. Broad is the road that leads to destruction, Jesus said. And many there be that go in there. Many people in this world will reject Jesus. You will be part of the minority. But it's okay. Let them get jittery. No problem. Let them get jittery. Because finally, ninthly and finally, you have the ecstasy. The joy. Ecstasy. E-C-T-A-S-Y. The ecstasy. Verse 28 and 30. Now she was talking with this woman. The woman was talking with Jesus. You know what? She was so joyous, so ecstatic. She left her bucket, ran to her village to tell everybody about Jesus. Yenda purpose kaga and bell vandala adu vandala. It'll happen when you're around somebody whom you, if you're around somebody whom you love or somebody whom loves you, you'll forget the world. You know, let's say that your parents have fixed you for marriage. And this boy is going to come and meet you in your house. You know, you think you will remember, what will you be conscious of? You'll remember where all there are buckets in your house and which all bathroom? No, you won't be thinking about bathroom buckets. When the boy who you're going to spend the rest of your life with whom you're going to wake up with every morning is going to come and see you, you will forget about everything. She forgot about everything because a joy unspeakable, full of glory, was gripping her. She was ecstatic, she forgot, she left her bucket and went back to her village and talked about Jesus to everybody. She believed in Jesus and was filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, as Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 8. Jesus is in the business of bringing joy to people. When he was in his mother's womb, Jesus is in his mother's womb. Who's Jesus' mother? Mary. And there was another baby who came close to him. He was also in his mother's womb. John was in the mother. Who's John's mother? Elizabeth. And when both these babies come together, because the mothers are coming together, they are still inside the mother's womb. The Bible says in Luke chapter 1 verse 44, John inside his mummy's womb, because Jesus is coming close to him, was jumping with joy. That's the Jesus I preach to you. He can make you jump for joy. He can make you jump for joy. He will give you a joy which the world cannot give, which money cannot buy, which the devil cannot take away. The joy which the world cannot give. Ulagam kudukka kudiyala santosham. Which the devil, which money cannot buy. Panam vaanga kudiyala santosham. And a joy which the devil cannot take away. Pisasai edukka mudiyala santosham. He will give you. But you know, what should you do? You need to repent from your sin and come to him. The Bible says, unless you repent, you too will perish. Perish is to go to hell and burn them forever. Life on earth will be hell and you'll go to a literal hell. Without Jesus, you're empty. You know, you seem to be happy on the outside, but you're empty. It's a hell for you. But you'll also go to a literal hell, a place of eternal fire, which Jesus talked about. Jesus talked about it 7, 8, 9, 8 times in the Word of God. Living hell and literal hell. Unless you repent, you too will perish. So that's the first thing. You need to repent. And then you need to believe. Put your faith in Jesus, who died for him on the cross. And then this joy will be yours. I want you to close your eyes. All eyes closed. All heads bowed. All eyes closed and all heads bowed. How many of you want this joy which the Samaritan woman had? And the Samaria pen petra and the Sandosham,
The bucket of marathitu urku odi poi. Andavaga Yesu Kristu pathi solugra santosham.
How many of you want that joy? That joy will be yours this morning when you repent from sin.
Paavathilirundhu manam thirumbi.
Andavaga Yesu Kristu udan nee varumbodhu adu kadaikkum.
Or madathil, not in a religion, it's in a relationship.
Andavaga Yesu Kristu udan andha uravinala varum.
To that relationship.
Do you want that joy?
எனக்கு அந்த சந்தோஷம் வேணும்.
நான் இன்றைக்கு மனம் திரும்பி இயேசுவிடம் வந்து அந்த சந்தோஷத்தை நான் பெற்றுக் கொள்கிறேன்.
You say that, I want you to raise your hand.
Raise your hand.
Do you want that joy?
Yes, today, Duke Jeyaraj, today I'm repenting from my sin and I'm coming to Jesus so that that joy will be mine, the joy of salvation.
I want you to raise your hand. Raise it high. Don't be ashamed.
Yes, I'm a sinner.
Yes, there are dirty things in my life which Jesus alone knows.
என்னுடைய வாழ்க்கையில பல காரியங்கள் இருக்குது, பாவமான காரியங்கள் இருக்கு,
அது இயேசுக்கு மாத்திரம் தெரியும்.
அதுல இருந்து மனம் திரும்புகிறேன். இன்றைக்கு
என்னுடைய வாழ்க்கையை இயேசுவிடம்
கொடுக்கிறேன்.
இல்ல அந்த மலையிலும் இல்ல, கல்வாரி மலைக்கு ஏறி என்னுடைய ஒரே வாழ்க்கையை அர்ப்பணித்து இயேசுவை பணித்துக் கொள்கிறேன்.
I will climb up the mountain Golgotha.
Surrender my life
and worship Jesus, not only today, for the rest of my life.
அப்படி சொல்றீங்கனா, I want you to, those of you raised your hand, get up from your seats.
எழுந்து,
if you raised your hand, get up from your seats.
If you raised your hand, get up from your seats.
Only if you raise your hand, not everybody.
Not everybody. Maybe you've gone away from Jesus.
Maybe you've gone away from Jesus.
Maybe you went away from Jesus.
But today, God is speaking to you through this
meditation on John chapter 4,
and he's telling you, come back,
sikrama, thirumba va,
you can come back.
Don't delay it.
Our life is not in our hands,
and after death, salvation, there's no chance for salvation.
Don't delay it. Jesus Christ is coming back
like a thief in the night to judge the world.
He's going to come back as a judge,
and it'll be too late for you to come to Jesus.
Don't delay it.
Because as I speak to you in the mic, there's another voice.
The voice of the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit says, repent, repent.
பரிசுத்தாவியானவர் பேசுகிறார், மனம் திரும்ப.
But if you say, no.
He will also, because he's a gentleman, the Holy Spirit is a gentleman.
God, the Holy Spirit is a gentleman.
He will leave you. He will stop speaking to you. And you can never be saved.
So don't turn off the volume of the Holy Spirit. Listen to the Holy Spirit.
He's speaking to you.
He's telling you what your sin is.
Rebellion against your parents.
He's telling you what your sin is.
Sexual sin maybe.
He's telling you what your sin is.
Maybe sin with your mouth, telling lies or using abusive language.
He's telling you what your sin is.
Maybe watching pornography.
Maybe he's telling you what your sin is.
Your sin may be envy and jealousy and pride.
Sins which the world cannot see, but sins nevertheless that are in your heart.
He is talking to you about your sin.
Repent.
Manam thirumbu.
Unless you repent, you too will perish, Jesus said,
which is to go to hell.
If you stay stubbornly in your sin, and if you stay away from Jesus, who's the only solution for sin,
hell is where we will go.
Hell is where we will go, but he doesn't want us to go there.
So repent.
As I'm speaking to you, I want you to pray with me.
I want you to pray
and say, Lord, I'm sorry.
In your own words, on your own, sonda vidathila sonda molila neenga jobane aadavare naan or paavi enna manniyum indha rathathinaala kalavu,
cleanse me with the blood that you shed for me on the cross of Calvary.
I should have died.
I should be beaten up publicly and stripped naked and hung on a cross,
but you took my punishment.
என்னுடைய ஆக்கின தீர்ப்பை நீங்க எடுத்துக்கொண்டீங்களே ஆண்டவரே.
அந்த அன்பை